Well, they give him his orders at Monroe, Virginia, saying, Steve, you're way behind time. This is not 38, this is old 97. You must put her in the dispenser on time. Then he turned around and said to his black greasy fireman, shovel on a little more coal. And when we cross that white oak mountain, watch old 97 roll. Danville in a line on a 3 mile grade. It was on that grade that he lost his air brakes. See what a jump he made. He was going down the grade, making 90 miles an hour. His whistle broke into a scream. He was found in the wreck with his hand on the throttle, a scalded to death by the steam. Telegram come to Washington Station, and this is how it read. Oh, that brave engineer that run old 97, he's a lion in old Danville dead. So now all you ladies, you better take a warning from this time on and learn. Never speak harsh words to your true loving husband. He may leave you and never return.
Thank you. Good evening. Good evening, everyone. And welcome to Public Transformation. This is a transportation webinar series where we will go on to a deep dive into the state of transportation in the United States. My name is Bakari Height, and I'm the Transit Equity Organizer with the Labor Network for Sustainability. For those of you who are unfamiliar with the Labor Network for Sustainability, or LNS, we're a relentless force for urgent science-based climate action. We are building a powerful labor climate movement to secure an ecologically sustainable and economically just future where everyone can make a living on a living planet. A great part of that future is a sustainable rail network. So we're excited to host this series to you all. To learn more about LNS and our projects, we urge you to visit our website at www.ln4s.org. That's www.ln4s.org. You can also follow us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram at LN4S. Before we move on, we'd like to shout out the Railroad Workers United for helping make this webinar possible and for their longstanding organizing for rail in the public interest. We would also like to acknowledge the Sierra Club's Rail Policy Subcommittee of Chapter Transportation Chairs, who recently put out a report and statement on rail transportation. We will drop the link in the chat so you can have a look at it. We would also like to give a shout out to the United Electrical Workers of Locals 506 and 618. They have been doing incredible work on this issue by launching a courageous strike for their quality jobs and demanding zero emission green locomotives. We would also like to acknowledge Bill Moyer and Amy Morrison of the team at Solutionary Rail and Tom White of the Climate Rail Alliance. Also, a huge shout out to all of the railroad workers, frontline environmental justice activists, and people who believe in a just, climate-safe rail system in the public interest. With that being said, let's get into why we picked a webinar series. Because the topic of transportation can't possibly be condensed in an hour, we wanted to do a series to allow leaders and organizers alike to share their experiences and knowledge for us to better understand how we can mobilize. Given the horrible incidents that have happened this year, such as the derailment in East Palestine, Ohio, the continued mistreatment of rail workers, the continuing pollution of frontline Black and Brown communities, and the destruction of our climate continuing pollution and caused by corporate control, fossil fuel burning, and transportation, this is proof that we need better operations. However, those operations are in control by the corporate Class I railroads. They have been the tipping point for what goes through certain points and what doesn't. And this begs the question, how can we have a freight railroad system in the public interest? Well, we wish to create that strategy, and we would like you to help us do so. And our panel tonight will begin to answer that question. Joining us now first to kick off our panel is Nick Wurst. Nick Wurst is a trainman based in Massachusetts. After a few years working in a non-union warehouse and a year as an IBEW apprentice, Nick started working on the railroad in 2019 as an intermodal worker and a member of the Transportation Communication Union. After his intermodal yard was sold to a contractor, he worked in a cardboard factory which ships rail and was a member of the United Steelworkers. He currently works as a freight conductor and is a member of the Smart TD Local 1473, as well as the Independent Socialist Group. Nick is representing Railroad Workers United at this webinar and serves on the Railroad Workers United Media Outreach Committee, Public Ownership Committee, and International Steering Committee. Nick, thank you for joining us on the panel.
Thank you for having me, and thanks for all the hard work for organizing this. And certainly makes me sound a lot more important than I feel I am. But I wanted to, everybody here tonight who's going to be speaking is an expert in their field and on all of the different elements at play here. So I think the most useful thing I can do is to try and give a brief context for the freight rail industry, the crisis that it's in now, what that means for workers as well as for others, and where railroad labor is at. So as Bakari mentioned, I'm a member of Railroad Workers United, which I joined shortly after starting working for the railroad because it was sort of obvious that it was the only group that was talking about the issues that railroad workers faced, but then also making the connection to what how the railroad impacts everything else and everybody else. And I think that was back in 2019, and now everybody's talking about the issues that railroad workers face, and especially how it impacts everyone else. So Railroad Workers United has started to put forward what we think is an answer to, or part of an answer to that question of how can we have a railroad system that runs in the public interest, which is our call for public ownership of the railroads. And for those for the rails to be run in public interest. So this is in response to the decline of the railroad system, especially the freight railroad system, but because of the dominance of the freight railroad system and the freight railroad companies, especially those class ones in the US, it's also, you know, the decline of freight is also the decline of passenger service, and it means problems for passenger and commuter services that for the most part have to run on freight owned trackage, and in a lot of ways are treated as a sort of second priority service, or and suffer the consequences of the class one's lack of maintenance and expansion and everything like that. So we have an industry that is making record profits, that's transformed itself in recent decades into a darling of Wall Street, and something that investors looking to make a buck can throw money at and be, you know, expecting reliable returns. But under the surface for years, and now very much publicly, the industry's in deep crisis. Despite those record profits, we're moving way less freight than we used to, and way worse than we used to. And it's had a knock-on effect even before back in April of 2022, there were hearings organized by the Surface Transportation Board, basically talking about the issue of the fact that the underperformance of the freight railroads was threatening agriculture, was threatening manufacturing, was holding up delivery of key goods and everything like that because of the crisis in staffing. And this was sort of in the lead up to the very big and very public contract fight that railroad workers had that was quote unquote solved when Congress imposed a contract on us in this past winter. So all of this has been accomplished, both the record profits and the massive decline of service, because of what they call precision scheduled railroading, which, you know, is nothing but a code word for, you know, running lean or doing more with less, right? Slashing as much as possible on expenses in order to prop up profits. And that's led to a decline in the workforce, both in terms of the numbers of workers, but also in terms of the experience of workers. So myself, I have, you know, less than 2 years as a train service employee, so a conductor, on the crew, and that's a lot of the train crews, especially conductors, are new guys like myself who have very little experience and are hiring into an industry that's in crisis, given not enough training, and getting put out there and being expected to make miracles happen. And beyond the crisis in the train crews, you have lack of staffing and lack of priority for maintenance, both of physical track, but also of the rolling stock of the cars, of the engines, the locomotives, the signal system. All of those workers have been similarly devastated in terms of numbers and are facing the same sort of incredibly unreasonable expectations of continuing to keep this whole thing, you know, staggering from crisis to crisis without ever really solving any kind of problems. So I just wanted to start to wrap up with talking about a few things. One is that obviously the freight railroad system is a very complicated thing, and it's something that is very bizarre to think about. It's like if you know, a company like UPS also happened to own big chunks of the interstate system and determined, you know, who could drive on it were responsible for its maintenance and everything like that. But there are sources of information for people who want to keep up with them. And obviously I'm a little biased, but I'll put forward Railroad Workers United, where we put out every week, we collect some headlines and try to explain some of them. And we regularly put out material on the various issues that are at play in the industry. But I just wanted to mention really quickly our public ownership campaign. We're working to put together with a lot of other of the organizations that are here on this call a real coalition to fight for public ownership of the railroads and to fight for those rails to be run in the public interest, not just for the benefit of getting freight where it needs to go safely and efficiently and in a way that doesn't devastate the economy, but also obviously to improve public transportation and to improve public safety. You know, I think the main thing I want to end on is that I've heard a lot of teachers use and nurses use sort of a phrase of, our working conditions are your child's learning conditions, or our working conditions are your patient's recovery conditions, right? I think it's been very clear over the last couple of years that railroad workers' conditions are the safety conditions of trackside communities. It's the and it's never been more apparent that this is an industry that needs some very serious change, and what we have right now is not cutting it, both in terms of the corporations that are running it, but also things like our unions and things like our elected officials, who are clearly not doing enough in order to push for some sort of alternative to the way things are currently run. And so that's what we're here to talk about today. So that's it.
So much, Nick Wurst from RWU, and thank you all for the work that you have been doing. And we're definitely going to share that link soon or later on into the panel. Next up, we have Ashley McCollum. Ashley is a domestic engineer who has been a resident of East Palestine, Ohio for the past 8 years. After the tragic accident on February 3rd, she has been fighting for help for residents in East Palestine and the surrounding areas, as well as collaborating with others from historical disaster sites. She and her family are unable to be at home for more than 40 minutes without having alarming symptoms and remain temporarily relocated. And she is still also waiting for Norfolk Southern to do the right thing. Ashley, thank you for joining us.
Hi, thank you for having me. So as of February 3rd, I'll just let you know my backstory. Before any of this happened and before I got to meet all these wonderful people, I had just a normal everyday life. Right before this happened, I was sitting on my couch thinking, wow, this was a great day. And then all of a sudden, an ambulance goes by, a fire truck. Then I hear another one into my town. It's on Common. I jumped up, looked out my front window, and I didn't see anything. Out of my back window, it looked like the entire town was on fire. Whenever I turned to my son, he started panicking. What do I do? What do I grab? What are we going to do, Mom? We need to leave. And I got down to him and I told him, grab what you can. I'm going to grab the dogs and we're going to go outside. It was full panic. Anything that you see in a movie, that is exactly how it was. You had to get to that understanding. Hey, this is do or die. You don't know what's going on. When I got outside, I noticed the fire looked like it wrapped around the entire town. A neighbor of mine said, a train derailed. At that point, I didn't believe it because it was so extensive. You could feel the heat. You can smell the chemical. I started to tell people to leave, and people were just in disbelief that this is happening. We don't have to evacuate. Then we started getting evacuated. At that moment, people were running down the roads, evacuating us. That was the last time I looked at my home as being a home, and it's still the same. And honestly, this could have been avoided multiple times. It's been talked about over and over again. And I'm just a normal person from a small town. This could happen anywhere. This could happen to anyone. The railways are a big supplier of everything we consume, we come in contact daily with. This does have to be better for us. I always remember hearing, if someone's in the railroad, you know, they're going to have a good living, a good retirement. And now it's a little bit different of a perspective here. You don't want that because those are important necessities, but we can't blame the people in the railroad because these aren't their own guidelines. These are the big companies above them. And from what I'm seeing and enduring, even now, practically being homeless and afraid to go back home without the help, there needs to be help and restructuring because this could happen to anyone on this call right now. The next day, every 3 days, a train derails. It could be prevented with more people walking the trains, more time to look at that 1 mile that now extends past a mile. When that train stops and it gets checked, we need to have multiple people checking. We need to make sure there's a better guideline because this will happen. It's not a matter of if or when it's going to happen again. But unfortunately, in my town, it was chemical related. Something that we may never clean. And we found today that our sewers are contaminated. It's just going back into our homes. So every day we find out something worse. This can be stopped and this can be avoided. I don't know if anyone has any questions for me. I'm kind of new to everything you guys are doing, but my son's father works with the railroad, so I understand the demand. It is hard.
Absolutely. And my thoughts are definitely with your family and the residents of East Palestine. You know how difficult it is as far as watching your town just completely change over time. And from what you mentioned, yes, like it seems to happen regularly, which is definitely why this call to action needs to happen. We provided a link if you'd like to support the residents of East Palestine, and we'll put it into the chat. East Palestine Justice is a ground team of individuals who are here to help folks seek and representation and to help navigate legal options. Their office is located at 319 North Main Street, Columbiana, Ohio, and their number is 330-584-9084. Again, that is 330-584-9084. And again, we'll put all of this in the description into the chat as well. Yes, we would definitely like to keep this alive just because, you know, we want to be able to prevent issues like this, and especially with these frontline communities and these communities where it is made up of working class folks. You know, we never want to lose the vitality of these communities, and especially ones where, you know, it depends on going through small towns. So, you know, we definitely thank you for sharing your story.
Thank you.
Thank you. Moving on, our next presenter is Yvette Arellano. Yvette is a Mexican-American Gulf Coast organizer based in Houston, Texas, home to 618 chemical manufacturers. They are the founder and director of Fenceline Watch, an environmental justice organization dedicated to the eradication of toxic multi-generational harm on fenceline communities. They were instrumental in the Center for International Environment Law, Plastic and Health, The Hidden Costs of a Plastic Planet. Yvette has testified before the EPA, federal, state, and intergovernmental bodies about public health impacts from toxic exposure and potential solutions. The advocacy focuses on protecting open and public processes, toxic exposure, community right to know, and chemical disasters fueled by expanding plastic production. The expansion of plastic production in the petrochemical sector has driven their participation in the Global Plastics Treaty with Break Free from Plastics Coalition. And Yvette is also a board member of the Center for International Environmental Law, Green Latinos, and Backbone Campaign. Yvette, thank you for joining us.
Thank you for having me. And I just, you know, wanted to start off by thanking you and the labor movement for involving environmental justice communities in your cause. Just to give you a little bit of background, Houston is home to over 618 chemical manufacturers. We produce about 40% of the nation's needs for everything from plastic to paints and so on. But for us, it also means there's a huge danger. So today, my conversation is going to be about solidarity from environmental justice communities, because we face similar dangers. We face dangers of multi-generational toxic harm, not just our bodies, not just today, but our children and our children's children. Like Nick said previously, hazardous work conditions are hazardous to our communities. Why? Because we have everything from a lack of transparency, and workers and communities are left out of conversations. We have a right to know what kind of chemicals are being transported. And all of this is driven by fossil fuel expansion, driven by loopholes, profit, and a lack of oversight and enforcement. Just, I wanted to present this map. I'm sure many of you are familiar with it. It's reported train derailments during this time period. And you can see that many of our communities are affected. communities like East Palestine. Thank you so much, Ashley, for sharing your firsthand experience, because on the front line of chemical production, oil refining, our communities are in danger. We are sitting ducks. And one of the things to consider is that when an emergency happens, there's a lack of transparency. Communities are left in the dark for hours while these chemical disasters happen. We have a lack of accountability from the Federal Railroad Administration, having inspection gaps where train cars are inspected once every 10 years. And then when the disasters do happen, that's when we find out that specific train cars have everything from polyvinyl chloride that can cause everything from rare cancers, liver, brain, cancers, all the way to lymphoma, leukemia. They damage our nervous systems, and they are mutagenic. They harm the fetus even before it's born. So here we are, workers and communities, experiencing all of these harms. Here, there's again the map of train derailments, and I superimposed also the EPA's cancer risk for our community. So you can see that our communities and workers are affected. And it's unfortunate that when disasters happen, it's so many times that lack of communication leads to road closures, lack of information to first responders. On a consistent basis, our homes that are next to rail yards are exposed to toxic chemicals through off-gassing. And again, we're already in vulnerable situations with a lack of health insurance and increasing cancer rates. And what are the conditions that cause this? We understand that, at least in refineries and in so many labor sectors, we have these toxic work systems like the DuPont shift schedule that force workers 12 plus hours shifts over 14 days, nonstop. Whereas we honestly hear workers say it's more than 16 hours. And it causes dangerous conditions. But why is it that producers want to do this? It's continuous production. Older workers are then forced to quit because they can't keep up. So there's a division even between generations of workers. They're able to lower insurance costs and even cut on pension plans. And to us, it transpires in when there's an incident, we have a lack of communication. Our communities that don't speak English as a first language are left out of the loop. Our undomiciled communities do not have anywhere to shelter in place. Most of us, including here where we work, we have AC units, so that exposure is very direct. And it doesn't leave a safe place for our communities to actually live, work, and play. Why is this happening? We're seeing an expanding fossil fuel project led by plastics. We've seen how the fossil fuel industry is basically using plastic as a lifeline, and they're profiting tremendously. We see them start to encroach on global plastics treaties like the one so many environmental justice communities and national partners are a part of. The thing with this is, if we don't start controlling the chemical sector and the fossil fuel sector, we're not going to be able to handle that plastics problem. That is then going to lead to even more situations where climate crisis hits us on the daily. Here we have news over how extreme heat actually warps tracks, again, increasing that harm. And then who ends up taking on the burden? Who pays the price for these derailments? It's once again environmental justice communities where the waste is then brought, like in East Palestine's case, was brought to the Houston Ship Channel through Texas Molecular with a harm risk of potentially being exposed to the public sector once again. So we need transparency. We need to stop being forced into these databases that push us to do extra work where we honestly don't have that expertise. And with public ownership of the rail system, we would have a right to ensure that we have healthy jobs and healthy communities, that workers and communities have safeguards, that there's true transparency and meaningful public input. And ultimately for us, a stop to toxic exposures, including workers, by calling for a halt on the fossil fuel sector so the trains don't get overburdened, so they're not extremely long, so they aren't getting so large where they can't even balance themselves on the rail lines. Overall, thank you so much for the opportunity to present and talk to folks today.
Thank you so much, Yvette Arellano, Fenceline Watch. Thank you so much. Wonderful. Well, with such a wonderful panel, we want to take a break and have a call to action really quickly. Nick mentioned it earlier about RWU's call to action as far as endorsing the public ownership of public rails. And we wanted to give you this forum so that you all could be equipped to know how to do so. So if you could look, here's the form, and all you have to do is click the link in the chat, and we're providing it in the chat now. You just fill out your org information, and if you have the authority to sign on your organization, just click yes on the form to endorse. Now, if you're not the authority figure that you can sign on to it, just click maybe, and we'll definitely follow up with you. But if you'd like to take 2 seconds and 2 minutes and do this, we will give you 2 minutes.
Well, I hear my train a coming. Hear my train a coming.
Welcome back. Next, we'll get to our next panelist, who is Paul Lindsay. Paul Lindsay is a 17-year employee and locomotive engineer of Union Pacific. He is also an embattled whistleblower being retaliated against for speaking out. He has been published multiple times in op-eds and has been speaking out on this issue in many forums. Paul, thank you for joining us.
Well, thank you for having me. I'll get right into it. I'll try to keep it as short as possible. I had to cut a lot out. So our economy is always changing, and the railroads are no exception. Every so often, a paradigm shift occurs as the world changes and adapts to the needs of society. But the rail industry wants to maintain a way of doing business that's outdated and hobbling our national economy. So railroads are the proverbial buggy whip industry, wanting protected while also claiming that they operate for private profits. One thing is a fact, though. The railroads never actually operating in a free market space they claim to operate in. So the Interstate Commerce Act of 1887 was the first paradigm shift. It created essentially a price-fixing scheme so that the railroads didn't have to compete with each other. It was sold to the public as not a way to lower rates when, in fact, rates actually went up during that time period, and it placed huge restrictions on pricing power of the railroads, which led to bankruptcies many decades later, but it also essentially created cartels, and they've behaved as such ever since. The railroads wanted to be regulated so that competition was limited and so their positions were protected. So the next paradigm shift came in 1917 when the U.S. railroads were nationalized during World War I. So during this time, the railroads were unable to meet demand for the war effort. They were unable to provide enough locomotives, cars. They weren't working with each other. They were constantly bickering with each other. And so during this time, the government nationalized the railroads and they produced somewhere around 2,000 locomotives and 100,000 rail cars of a standard USRA design. It helped the industry. It was taxpayer money going into making the industry standard and work well, and it helped them well into the future. So the Plum Plan actually wanted to make the nationalization permanent, but it failed, and the system unfortunately went back to private hands in 1920. But even after, the companies continued to copy these USRA standard designs and operating practices. So it couldn't have been all that bad. So fast forward 43 years and the Staggers Rail Act of 1980 deregulated the industry. In reality, it just reversed the regulations they wanted so badly in 1887. By this time, you had trucks and highways and other public infrastructure. And so this regulatory structure on them, all of a sudden, they're whining, oh, we can't compete. Because, yeah, they're not the only game in town anymore. It was about this time that massive rail systems started to go into bankruptcy and get bailed out. So the Penn Central was the largest bankruptcy in American history to date, and it nearly brought down the entire U.S. transportation system. Its bankruptcy brought down other smaller railroads, and it brought down businesses that rely on rail service, bankrupted businesses. It was a complete disaster. So long story short, a new nationalized, quasi-nationalized rail system called Conrail was put into place, and it worked well. And it was the only thing that prevented a complete collapse in rail transportation at the time. So the conversation for public ownership should have started then, but unfortunately it didn't. Instead, we deregulated the industry and Conrail was eventually privatized again. And here we are 43 years later at a new paradigm shift. So where are we now? The railroads are ultra profitable. So profitable, in fact, they've repurchased $136 billion of their own shares just since 2015. So $136 billion has been siphoned from electrification, double track, passenger service, maintenance, rolling stock, locomotives. That money's gone, just poof. It doesn't produce any economic value, it's gone. And what have they done to pay for this? They've cut maintenance, they've cut employees, they've cut locomotives and facilities, until we're essentially seeing the same problems with rail that sparked rail nationalization in 1917. So recently, Foster Farms this year, the largest producer of chickens and turkeys in the country, they weren't receiving the grain they needed from Union Pacific, and they were just days away from having to kill off thousands and thousands of birds. So a letter from the FRA recently, as of just a few days ago, stated that on inspection, 73% of locomotives and almost 20% of rail cars had federal defects on a random inspection. And when the FRA inspectors tried to talk to the railroad management about it, the railroad management was trying to harass them and tell them to get off the property. They're slowing down production. So private monopolies, they discourage growth and innovation, because why would you want to invest into growth and innovation when you can just siphon money into your own pocket instead? So if you want safe and accountable, well-maintained rail systems, then you need to support public ownership, because you will never get that under our current system of private ownership. If you support, if you care about the environment and want to see more electrification, you need to support public ownership of the rails, because it will never happen otherwise. If you care about passenger trains and developing walkable transit-oriented development in cities, you need to support public ownership of our rail infrastructure, because these railroad giants will never cooperate to make it happen. So public ownership, it's not extreme, and it's not even partisan. We use publicly owned roads every single day. We don't siphon highway funds into share buybacks. And if anyone were to suggest that we need a trucking company to take control of an interstate, the idea would just be laughed away as ridiculous. So when is the last time our locks and our waterways paid a dividend to Wall Street? Last I checked, there's no stock ticker for the Army Corps of Engineers. Rail is the only outlier, and it shows. There's no real competition in rail, and there's no incentive to grow our rail network. So since 2006, the U.S. rail industry has actually shrunk by 21%, which is the wrong direction, because that's the most environmentally friendly way to haul freight. So the big rail companies blame the decline on coal, but they're purposeful strategic cuts. The name of the game is to keep only the most profitable captive shippers, drive the rest away onto our subsidized highways. So the result is that taxpayers are essentially subsidizing the railroads to buy back their own shares, since our publicly owned highway systems backstop their lack of investment into growth. So Pandora's box has already been opened. You can't physically break the rail systems apart. It would make the problem worse. The only way to correct this crisis is for this vital rail infrastructure to be publicly owned like our highways. So what does public ownership in the rail industry actually mean? It's open access. It's a well-maintained modern rail system. New operators can enter the market. If a government entity wants to run a new passenger train, a private railroad monopoly can't stop them. If new freight carriers want to enter the market, there's nothing stopping them. Companies like Union Pacific and Norfolk Southern will need to actually innovate if they hope to survive. Under this system, nothing stops customers themselves from hauling their own freight. If there's a large company that has a lot of carloads, they can have their own locomotives and cars and use it, as long as they pay the usage fees to use the publicly funded infrastructure. So I want to conclude by pointing to this on the horizon right now. For years, I've spoken about share buybacks and the way that it's destroying the industry that I love. That $136 billion in share buybacks was largely paid for by going into debt and wrecking the balance sheets of these companies long term. So if a company like Union Pacific were to fail, it would be as devastating to the economy as the Penn Central in 1970. When we should have, and back then in 1970, like I said, is when we first should have started having the discussion of publicly owned national rail network system. If we were to allow these private rail giants to own our infrastructure outright, outright, there will be a bankruptcy in the future, because that's what they want. They're too big to fail. And until they fail, they'll just continue siphoning capital away from our rail network, away from electrification, and away from a sustainable future. So privatized gains, subsidized losses, we've all heard that. And that's why we're calling for public ownership of our national rail network. Thank you.
Thank you. Paul Lindsay, that is wonderful and just an amazing history, and just the shame of all that money that was lost that could be gone towards a better system. We thank you for all of this history. Wonderful. Well, moving on next, we have Helen Yost. Helen is a co-founder and community organizer of Regional Climate Activist Collective, Wild Idaho Rising Tide, and producer and host of the weekly Climate Justice Forum program on KRFP Radio Free Moscow since 2011, advocating for frontline resistance to fossil fuels extraction, transportation, and infrastructure expansion. In the wake of the 1989 Exxon Valdez oil tanker wreck and spill in Alaska home waters, Helen has worked with dozens of grassroots environmental restoration and indigenous advocacy groups across the five-state Northwest through creative direct action, outreach, and board member service, receiving extensive recognitions and international media coverage. Helen studied and earned degrees with honors with a BS in Conservation of Resources, Wildlife, and Wilderness Environments from the University of Montana-Missoula, and a master's in Environmental Education, Ecology, and Botany from Oregon University Ashland, and a PhD from the University of Idaho, Moscow in Natural Resource and Social Sciences. Helen, thank you for joining us.
All right, thank you very much. I put together a prepared statement earlier, so bear with me as I rush through this in solidarity with people all over Turtle Island or North America, rejecting new and expanding fossil fuels infrastructure to protect the water, air, and climate essential to all lives. Wild Idaho Rising Tide, or WRT, climate activists and Northwest communities in the crosshairs of the coal, oil, and railroad industries actively oppose the pipeline on rails of Burlington Northern Santa Fe Railway, or BNSF, Union Pacific, or UP, and Montana Rail Link, or MRL. These three rail lines converge in Sandpoint, Idaho, including at a regionally rare at-grade crossing, and threaten lands, lives, and livelihoods along rail routes from the northern Great Plains to West Coast export terminals, oil refineries, ports, industrial facilities, and power plants. BNSF moves an average of 4 daily unit trains of Powder River Basin coal, 8 to 12 weekly trains of volatile fracked Bakken crude oil, and occasional petroleum coke and ethanol trains, while Union Pacific hauls 1 to 2 trains per week of equally explosive and irretrievably sinkable Canadian tar sands. Both transport about a dozen daily manifest trains carrying hazardous materials along and over North Idaho and Northwest rivers, lakes, and tributaries increasingly vulnerable, like rail infrastructure, to the floods, landslides, and wildfires of fossil fuel climate chaos. This railroad use, expansion, and deterioration recklessly endangers communities with ongoing increasing pollution from heavy metal-laden coal and carcinogenic diesel locomotive emissions, and the risks of catastrophic wrecks, spills, explosions, and wildfires, which occur twice daily throughout the country, sparked by trains driven by exhausted, understaffed crews through the rugged, dry, mountainous, forested West. During the 10 years since the deadly July 2013 Lac-Mégantic tragedy, dozens of similar oil train wrecks have harmed public and environmental health and safety and the global climate more than in the previous 4 decades. Within 44 miles of Sandpoint, during 7/2017 months, BNSF, MRL, and UP imposed 6 North Idaho and Northwest Montana train derailments and collisions. Trains struck 2 vehicles with 4 teenagers, killing one. A grain train slid down a mountainside toward a dam. An empty coal train jumped the tracks close to homes, and a corn train derailed and dented U.S. Highway 95 on the same day as BNSF started preliminary test pile driving for its rail bridge expansions near Sandpoint. This streak culminated with the train dumping 7,000 pounds of coal upstream of Pendere Lake and River freshwater sources and 40% of Columbia River Basin flows. Fully laden flammable crude oil and hazardous materials trains pass through deep riverside mounds of wreckage and spontaneously combusting smoldering coal abandoned during 5 weeks of a smoky wildfire season. After its July 2020 derailment of a mixed freight train into the Kootenai River, BNSF deserted its submerged lead locomotive for a month as it leaked more than 2,000 gallons of diesel fuel into an international watershed. Crews then floated or dragged the 500,000-pound engine across the river habitat of 3 endangered fish species important to indigenous tribes, and dismantled and removed it on a river bar. The second largest consumer of climate-wrecking diesel fuel in the world, behind the U.S. Navy, and one of the top funders of climate change denial propaganda to buttress its coal transportation interests, the BNSF Railway runs trains that burn over 110 gallons of diesel per mile. During 4 years since autumn 2019, when the Sandpoint Junction Connector Project received its deficiently environmentally reviewed permits and big green groups turned their backs on the invasion until summer 2023 completion, the Class 1 railroad has destructively built 2 miles of double tracks and 3 parallel second and probably later third rail bridges through the tiny recreation and arts town of Sandpoint. And those are Overbridge Street, which is the only way out to the an important city park and various condos and a hotel, and at the Sand Creek outlet into Lake Pend Oreille, and almost 1 mile across Idaho's largest, deepest lake, the foundation of the local tourism economy. Venus have drilled, removed, and re-drilled over 1,000 piles into released sediment from train spewed accumulated pollution and buried lead leaching communication cables in lake and stream beds to anchor noisily floating fish killing temporary barges, precariously balancing tall half million pound scenic view marring construction cranes and other fossil fueled equipment. This heavy industrial expansion now accommodates noticeably and dangerously faster, longer, more derailment vulnerable bi-directional train traffic, polluting the federally designated critical habitat of the threatened species bull trout, migratory birds, and other native inhabitants, lake and aquifer drinking water, and regional airsheds. Despite contrary claims by BNSF, during ugly obstructive site preparation and construction, additional trains also inevitably impose an increase road rail congestion, ungated crossing collisions, and night train noise. Many derailments toss 75-foot-long train cars perpendicular to tracks, which over Lake Ponderay lie only 50 parallel feet apart. Meanwhile, distractive community support, showboated by BNSF, has trained emergency responders for hazardous spills that are mostly uncontainable, bought off food banks, emergency services, and others with grant donations, and propagandized through endless media ads that the North Idaho economy, based on natural amenities, somehow needs BNSF and its unhealthy, fume-spewing, lake-shaking, allegedly climate-friendly 60 and counting daily trains. Word expensively litigated state permit approval of BNSF's Sandpoint expansion, and along with the Northwest Network, continues to advance public vigilance, education, and participation, coordinate and host direct action training workshops and frontline protests, daily monitor, photograph, and publicly report westbound loaded fossil fuel trains and railroad construction abuses, document environmental and socioeconomic violations, and gather evidence challenging permit reviews and decisions by local, state, and federal agencies. Especially since billionaire investor Warren Buffett purchased BNSF for investment purposes over a decade ago, private railroads operate more for greedy corporate profits than for actual transportation of consumer goods, especially on the longest double-stacked intermodal trains, of exported industrial agriculture products that counter the imported trinket glut, and of the constant onslaught of fossil fuels and hazardous materials that jeopardize and forever contaminate trackside communities and environments, like the February 2023 East Palestine, Ohio disaster. If public ownership of railroads can effectively improve the inherent cumulative environmental destruction, significant community damages, degraded rail employee health, unsafe working conditions, dismissal of sacrifice zone resident concerns, and even possible self-sabotage of this bullying dinosaur industry, like the December 2020 Custer, Washington, and June 2016 Mosier, Oregon, and other oil train derailments, blaming activists or promoting pipelines, Wurst and our grassroots and indigenous allies across the Northwest gratefully support the efforts of the Labor Network for Sustainability and other working class heroes in achieving public transportation for the common good. Thanks so much, everyone.
Thank you, Helen Yost of Wild Idaho Rising Tide. That was a really wonderful and powerful statement. Last but not least, we have Thomas Hanna. Thomas is an independent researcher and author, and he is the president and founder of the Institute for a Democratic Economy and Society and a former research director of the Democracy Collaborative. Thomas has authored dozens of reports, papers, and articles that have been published in both popular and academic journals. In 2018, his book, Our Commonwealth, The Return for Public Ownership in the United States, was published by Manchester University Press. Thomas is recognized internationally for his work on creating a more democratic and participatory forms of public enterprise and organization, and he has served on the boards of multiple organizations and projects. Thomas received a master's and bachelor's degrees in history from Virginia Commonwealth University and is currently pursuing a PhD in political economy at the University of Glasgow. Thomas is a first-generation immigrant to the United States, having arrived as a child in the early 90s. He lives in Virginia with his partner and two children. Thomas, thank you for joining us.
Thank you so much. Good evening, everyone. It's really great to see so many people on this webinar. So I'm going to close out tonight by talking about the surprising scope and scale of public ownership in the United States, both today and historically. And if you all are anything like me before when I started studying this topic, you may have this idea of the US as this sort of beating heart of free market capitalism where everything is privately owned and there isn't really any room for alternatives. And so hopefully by the end of my 7 minutes here, I'll have been able to help kind of dispel some of these myths and hopefully convince you all that there are possibilities here in the US for alternative models of ownership. So first, what exactly is public ownership? For me, I define public ownership as assets, services, and enterprises that are owned collectively by all people in a specific geographic area and managed either directly or indirectly through representative structures. Most usually those indirect structures are government agencies at various levels. The term by all people for me is really important because it distinguishes public ownership, not only from private forms of ownership, but also from some of the other more democratic forms of ownership like cooperatives and other things that are membership based. So in other words, in those other cases, ownership is held by some subset of the general population in an area, whereas public ownership is held by all people in a given geographic area. So, all right, sometimes I joke that public ownership is as American as apple pie. There are around 2,000 publicly owned electric utilities in the United States that along with cooperatives provide about 25% of the nation's power. In one state, Nebraska, I was fascinated when I found this out. Nebraska, every single resident and business receives electricity from a publicly owned utility or cooperative, and most of those are publicly owned utilities. Around 85% of the US population is served by a publicly owned water system. And this is really significantly higher than many other economies around the world, especially places like the UK, where they've really privatized a lot of water in recent years with pretty disastrous results, as you can imagine. Nearly all public transportation systems in the US, you know, buses, subways, trams, those are in public ownership. Many cities own land and buildings, which they then use in various ways to support local economic development. This includes things like public markets, hotels, convention centers, and so on. By law, most commercial airports in the United States need to be publicly owned. I think there's only one privately owned airport in the US. So there's around 4,000 publicly owned airports. Similarly, there are hundreds of publicly owned commercial ports in the US. So between airports and ports, you're talking about publicly owned entities that directly and indirectly support, you know, millions and millions of jobs and trillions of dollars in economic activity. Around 20% of community hospitals are publicly owned. And in some states, the state government has actually set up publicly owned clinics for state employees so that they can reduce healthcare costs and provide long-term preventive care. In many states, public ownership of alcohol distribution facilities is the norm, and they serve as major revenue producers, which in turn helps pay for education, public works, police, fire, and so on. Several US states own these really large publicly owned investment funds, sometimes called sovereign wealth funds, and they own these funds, they own stocks, real estate, land, other assets, and then they sometimes use the revenues to support social services in the state like public education in Texas, or as in the case of Alaska, provides an annual cash dividend to all residents. North Dakota has a 100-year-old, really highly successful publicly owned bank. It has a publicly owned grain mill and elevator, which has been around about a similar amount of time. Wisconsin operates a publicly owned life insurance company. The city of Milwaukee has produced and sold milorganite, which is, I probably mispronounced that, but it's an organic fertilizer derived from the city's water reclamation process, and they've been selling that for about 100 years. There's more than 500 publicly owned broadband internet networks across the country. You have the U.S. Postal Service, the Tennessee Valley Authority, the Veterans Administration, Social Security. You know, I could really just keep going on and on like this all night, but we should probably get to the topic of rails. So Paul did a great job earlier talking a little bit about the history of rail, but as you all probably know, on the passenger side, we have a publicly owned enterprise called Amtrak. Again, very different from many other countries around the world that went about privatizing their trains. Again, like the UK, my favorite foil in this conversation, UK privatized its trains, absolute disaster in British trains if you've ever been there. And so this is a good segue into a little bit of history. So Amtrak was created in the early 70s after the collapse of Penn Central, as Paul mentioned, and that was a horribly mismanaged corporate giant. The creation of Amtrak was just one of like hundreds of times in our history that the government has stepped in and deployed public ownership in times of economic or social crises across a really wide variety of industries: telecoms, mining, manufacturing, transportation, banking. We have just nationalized repeatedly throughout American history. It happens, you know, quite often. As if anyone remembers the last financial crisis, it happened, you know, with all the banks and so on and so forth. So in the rail industry, it happened during World War I, happened again with Amtrak, happened again with the creation of Conrail in the early 1970s. And one thing I always like to remind people about Conrail is how successful it really was under public ownership. When Conrail was reprivatized by Reagan and by the Reagan administration in the late 80s, it was the largest IPO, initial public offering, in US history up to that point. It had really been turned around under public ownership. But dealing with crises, you know, these crises that are often caused by private corporations, it's just one of the many reasons why public ownership has been so popular in the United States historically. And in addition to sort of distributing the fruits of ownership more broadly, or as broadly as possible, one of the other key benefits of public ownership is it's a really flexible form of ownership that can be used to address whatever needs that are prioritized by a local population. So in other words, unlike private companies, private corporations, public owned enterprises are not necessarily constrained or beholden to these market imperatives such as growth or profit or competition. So if you want to prioritize employment or better working conditions, you can. If you want to prioritize community or environmental safety, you can. If you want to prioritize passenger rail expansion, yeah, you can do that. And obviously, you know, we can't really be naive here. I mean, these are contestable institutions, right? And there's a lot of competing interests around any public service. But the main point really still stands. When you move from a private for-profit service to a public not-for-profit service, your range of options for how that service can be used and how it can be organized really expands dramatically. And so that just brings me to my final point. You know, given that these are contestable institutions, you know, they're sometimes no better than private companies. Sometimes they can be even worse, right? We have to contest for publicly owned enterprises. We have to make them what we want. We have to have them reflect our priorities. So that's why I advocate for a sort of a different model of public ownership. I call it democratic public ownership. And I don't really have the time to get into the details too much tonight, but very briefly, democratic public ownership, it's about centering worker and community participation and control, increasing transparency and public accountability, and enshrining values such as equity and sustainability and social benefit. And I'll just close out really briefly by saying one of the very earliest prototypes of democratic public ownership came from here in the United States, and it came from the rail sector. I think Paul and others have mentioned the Plum Plan. So the Plum Plan, as people have discussed, was a plan for permanent public ownership of the railroads, but it was also a democratic model. The Plum Plan would have resulted in a multi-stakeholder governance structure with a board that had representation from workers, from officials, and from the public. So thank you all so much for being here. Really appreciate it. Love to keep the conversation going.
Absolutely. Thomas, Hanna, thank you for joining us. And a huge round of applause to our whole entire panel. This has been an absolutely informative panel. And we're going to bring everyone back in so we can have some questioning. But I just want to just thank you all for joining us and just dropping all of your knowledge and gems on us. But I wanted to bring it back to the point that Thomas was making, in that, you know, we have all of these public entities in the country, and they've seemed to have worked, especially these airports. In this day and age where California is experiencing a hurricane before Florida does, or Portland, Oregon's experiencing 100 degree days, should climate change really be the catalyst for a public ownership of rail? And anyone can answer this.
Guess I'll jump in as a climate activist and say, it should be the health of communities and workers and the economy as a whole that probably should inform how railroads are run more than anything. And you know, climate is just sort of the aftermath of poor corporate decisions regarding health and you know, community rights and such. So it's something to consider, especially, you know, we deal with a lot of diesel pollution here in Sandpoint, the lake, because it's so huge, holds a lot of that pollution in the air, especially in the winter, and it's unhealthy. And communities everywhere along tracks have to deal with that. But the pollution comes first, the climate change comes second. So I think pollution really should, you know, trump climate concerns, and that's coming from a climate activist.
I'd say, go ahead. I'd say definitely 100%. We have to talk about climate when we're talking about fossil fuels, when we're talking about trains, because it's affecting us. Taxpayer dollars are having to go to fix the roads that are buckling, to fix the infrastructure that is being torn apart. And we're not getting that kind of information over how much is actually costing us outside of emergency room visits because of toxic exposure. This is a day-to-day thing. It is crippling our infrastructure. So being that railroads are one of the largest pieces of infrastructure, we have to start talking about what does electrification look like? What does it look like to shift away from fossil fuels over to passenger transportation?
If I can jump in for just a second to recommend that if people haven't already, check out the United Electrical Workers Green Locomotive Project. So I think combined with what Paul laid out about how much shipping has been pushed to trucking, and the fact that the railroads are more and more interested in doing point-to-point stuff instead of local service and really driving away customers, as many customers as they can, in order to be able to dumb down operations and cut as much as possible. If you combine sort of public ownership of the rails, especially prioritizing expansion to former customers and new customers, to get as much shipping onto the rails as possible, right? Not to threaten truckers' job security or anything like that, because they've got plenty of their own problems, right? But if you combine that with things like talking about electrification and green locomotive project and things like that, then you start to see something that is more like is some sort of environmentally sustainable rail network. But I work for a class one, and they do a lot of greenwashing. There's a lot of propaganda about, you know, we move so much freight with, you know, X number of gallons of diesel. The reality is there's so many idling trains. There's so many idling locomotives. There's freight spends more time not moving because of the crew crisis and the crisis in the industry than they do moving. Right. So, there's a huge amount of potential there, but it's got to take something dramatically different.
Absolutely. Paul, you had a comment? Paul, did you have a comment? Maybe not. I wanted to give the panelists a chance to ask each other questions. We've heard from everyone, but I wanted to give you all a chance to see if there was something that you'd like to ask your fellow panelists in any questions that were presented today. So anyone have any questions for the panelists to another panelist?
I have a question. My question's about the fossil fuel sector. So we see fossil fuels expanding, petrochemicals, oil refining, gas exports. How is that affecting the rail sector and making it potentially more dangerous?
Any response?
I guess I can try and take that. I don't know. I think we call them bomb trains for a reason. You know, I don't know. It just connects with the crisis of not just staffing numbers, but also experience, and the fact that maintenance has been slashed so much and car inspectors are under so much pressure to, you know, inspect so many cars so quickly. And I'm pretty sure there's a whole lot of ducking and dodging of requirements already. I know there are, but I'm not gonna but I think everything gets more dangerous the minute you add anything. I mean, a 2 mile long grain train is inherently dangerous, right? But then you add explosives and flammables to the mix and it gets even worse. You can see how many fatalities and derailments and destruction is from quote unquote non-hazmat, right? Or non-hazardous trains. And then you throw in fossil fuels, anything like that. Just makes everything worse.
I'll just jump in real quick and say that climate change is a major, major factor in all of our nation's infrastructure. And I'll channel Paul, I think, who mentioned it earlier. You're just not going to address these infrastructure challenges in the time frames needed, dictated by climate change, under private ownership. You're going to need public ownership in order to be able to upgrade our nation's transportation infrastructure in order to be able to deal with the effects of climate change.
Wonderful. We have time for one question, and I see Barry is here and has his hand raised. Barry, I'll unmute you and you can ask a question.
Yeah, I'd like to know what the panel thinks is the most promising technology for decarbonizing the locomotives.
Someone, can you hear me?
Yes.
I'd like to answer that.
Go ahead.
Everyone hear me?
Yes. Okay.
Yeah, that's an obvious one, and that's electrification. And it's not new. They do it they do it around the world. I mean, they have vast electrified systems in the world, and we had significant rail electrified rail infrastructure in the U.S. at one time. So someone mentioned living up in Sandpoint, just around your neck of the woods. The Milwaukee Road had electrification on mainline freight through the mountains all the way from Harlan, Montana to Avery, Idaho, and from Beverly, Washington, all the way to Tacoma. And that is the solution. You're not going to be able to modify these diesel locomotives to be clean, like I heard earlier. My internet was cutting out. Someone talking about these engines idling, and that's the case. They don't run antifreeze coolant in these locomotives like we use in cars. They use water with essentially a rust inhibitor, and they idle. They idle all winter long. They're not clean. They don't run DEF. They don't run emissions equipment like in trucks. Diesel locomotives need to go away. And the only way to do that is electrification. And you are never going to get the private railroads to put electrification in because they don't want to spend any money.
Thank you for that question. And before we close out, we wanted to do a special spotlight out for Magda Orlander from Derail the Sail. Matt, if you're still here, would you like to talk about Derail the Sail?
Muted.
Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Sorry about that. Technology, it's a weird thing. We're in the 21st century and somehow we're still struggling with it, even after the pandemic. No, I'll keep it short. So I'm in Cincinnati. I'm with a coalition that was called Derail the Sail, because as some of you might heard about, but maybe not all of you, the city of Cincinnati has decided to put, well, we're talking about like the public ownership of rail, right? We're all in favor of the public ownership of rail here, or that's what I assume, because I know I am. The city of Cincinnati owns the last publicly owned interstate railroad that is publicly owned in the country. 337 miles from Cincinnati, Ohio, all the way down to Chattanooga. And through a whole bunch of like deals and negotiations and very shady, including 2 years of negotiations that should have been public, but that were secret, despite sunshine laws, they have decided to put on the ballot whether or not we should sell the railroad, the last publicly owned interstate railroad in the country. And there's a $5 million campaign, $5 million invested into the propaganda to sell this railroad. You're telling this is, oh, no new taxes, whatever. So I'm going to keep it brief. We don't want to sell our railroad to Norfolk Southern. A community coalition has emerged over the past few months. We've been working together with DSA, with Railroad Workers United, with various affinity groups locally to mount an opposition to this, because we all know that there ain't nothing good going to come out of selling the railroad to Norfolk Southern of all players. And so we are going to have a public teach-in. We had our first public event last week. I will put some information in the chat. You can get in touch with derailthesalesincy at gmail.com. We're kind of still setting up our infrastructure because we're an all-volunteer grassroots organization that has formed around opposing the sale. We do not want to see our railroad get put into the private hands of Norfolk Southern. That does not need to happen. And it's not in the benefit of the citizens of Cincinnati. It's not in the benefit of anybody from here down to Chattanooga, Tennessee. It's definitely of it. Don't bear out just putting all kinds of money into Wall Street to expect to get like a better return than we would get on a lease. It's just not, this is not going to bear out. And we would lose 337 miles of train tracks that we could be, well, we would lose like transparency, oversight. And of course, like the possibility of passenger rail to be asserted over those tracks. So I would definitely, I'm going to put the information about the campaign in the chat. I'm sorry, I feel like I'm going long, but I'm really fired up about the whole panel tonight from everybody who's been here on labor's side, on the environmental and sustainability side. We have a world to win. The city of Cincinnati has been negotiating for 2 years and is coming out saying like, hey, I guess we can't get a better lease, so we're just going to sell this thing off. If anybody here would be in this room negotiating a collective bargaining agreement and was told, well, this is our last, best, and final, and it was like an outsourcing deal that was kneecapping its members, you wouldn't tell your members to vote yes to ratify that contract. And we're out here telling the citizens of Cincinnati, like, this is not a good deal. Do not ratify this contract. Send your reps to negotiate a better one. So that's where we're at. The House of Labor in Cincinnati, unfortunately, is divided. But yeah, we're undeterred. So
stop.
I'm going to close out of that. It's been a long day, y'all, but I am so thankful to be here with everybody and look forward to staying in this fight with everyone. Thank you all for the time.
Thank you, Magna Orlander, and definitely go support that initiative. Well, I thank you all, and I absolutely thank the panelists for coming up and sharing all their knowledge and just telling their stories. We thank you so much, and we thank you all for attending. Please join us for our next series and webinar in this series that's coming up soon. Keep a lookout for your emails. And also, if you would like to support and sign the endorsement from RWU, we will drop the link in the chat, and we'll also provide it in your contacts when you go out. But from me and from the LNS and from all of our panelists, I would like to thank you all so much. And I would like to wish you all a great evening. And thank you so much for your attention. This is recorded, and we will definitely share this link with you all so you can have it all at your disposal. But from everyone at LNS and from all the panelists, my name is Bakari Height. I hope you all have a wonderful evening.
Thanks, Bakari. Thanks to the whole panel.
Thank you all.
Thank you, everybody.
Thanks, everybody.